Hi guys, this is Mary with Mark Kills, and today I am back with another book review. This time I will be talking about Milkfed by Melissa Broder. So I literally read this book in 3 days and it's 288 pages, I think. I found it at my local library. And I had heard of it on Instagram. I think it was recommended to me by some accounts that I followed. Plus, I really liked the cover. And as you guys know, I'm a very visual person. So I decided to give it a try. And I was not expecting it to be this relatable, at least to me. I do not have like an official history of eating disorders, but there are some behaviors that are related with food, which are described in this book, that I absolutely relate to. But first of all, who is Melissa Broder? So she's an American author. She's, besides this novel, she also published The Pisces, which is also on my reading list. So as soon as it becomes available at the library, I will be reading that one too. And she currently lives in Los Angeles, which is where the novel is based. And fun fact, she is a caregiver for her husband who suffers from some sort of disease that, because of this disease, he's like bedridden for months at a time. So she's also a caregiver to him, which in my opinion is a really big commitment, you know? So it's really interesting. So, talking about Milkfed, I was hooked from the very first sentence, and I'll be reading it to you right now. So, the novel starts like this. It didn't matter where I lived, mid-city, mid-Wilshire, or Miracle Mile. It didn't matter where I worked, when Hollywood Bullshit Factory was equal to any other. All that mattered was what I ate, when I ate, and how I ate it. So, who's the protagonist of Milkfed? It's a young woman called Rachel. She lives in Los Angeles. She works at a think talent agency in Hollywood, if I'm not wrong, where they scout up-and-coming stars for movies and TV series. She's originally from New Jersey. So far, so good. So she's just like any other American woman pursuing maybe her dreams, maybe working at a random 9-to-5 job. But here's what's interesting is that she's an anorexia survivor. And even though right now she's not the minimum, she doesn't weigh like she used to weigh, she still has some behaviors that are not serving her. So the book starts with this sentence. And after that, Rachel goes on to describe her very strict eating regime, which consists of nicotine gums to relieve the stress, because I think she says that she cannot smoke because nobody smokes in Hollywood. Then that she doesn't eat until lunch or something. So she has breakfast number one, which are the nicotine gums. Then breakfast number two is like some very low calorie yogurt. And then she has like a very light lunch, which consists of a salad and yogurt. Then the afternoon, I believe that she has like a very light snack, Then after work, she spends 3 hours at the gym because she has to burn something like 2,500 calories, which is like insane. And in the evening, when she comes back home, she basically eats other very low calorie foods, but like all at once, as if to like fill herself. And then the next day she starts again. So this is like a very unhealthy, these are very unhealthy eating habits. So like why is she like this? Then she here and there she throws hints at like her mother, her history with eating disorders, and how her mother would make fun of her for being for not being thin enough, and for just like fat shaming her even though she was not fat. I think a lot of us can relate to this, even those that do not have like eating disorders, but this kind of like fat shaming or like pressure from our parents, I think it's very relatable. And also, another thing I forgot to mention is that she is Jewish, so there's like there's a lot of Jewish imagery in this novel. I think there are many themes that like Melissa Broder was able to like condense in just one novel, and I'll try to like resume them right now. So put on mascara and your party dress. I'm your mess. The first one that I wanted to talk about is mommy issues. So Rachel is a lesbian, and even though she's dated men, she's pretty sure that she's a lesbian. And she says that she has a very like peaceful relationship with her father. Like they're not close, but like she barely even talk about her father. The sort of like the origin of all her traumas are is her mother, who still sort of like she doesn't feel like her mother's proud of her. She doesn't feel like she can ever please her mother, but she cannot stop talking to her. And when her therapist proposes a 90-day detox, she kind of panics at first, and then I think she manages until like 60 something days. But yeah, that's pretty much to say that like her mother is still with her, and her judgments are still pretty much with her, like they didn't go anywhere. So put on mascara and your party dress. I'm your national. The second thing that we can find, as I mentioned before, is the theme of food. Rachel fantasizes about food all day, every day, basically, but she really cannot let herself slip. She cannot slip, and she cannot let herself go to like those foods that she really wants to eat and that she really craves. So much so that she dreads the business lunches with her boss and her team, because she cannot like count the calories properly. She doesn't know what she's eating, or she has to like buy a ton of diet muffins. Because if she doesn't have them, like she starts panicking or something. Another thing that's really funny to me is that she lives in LA, which is like the diet culture and like keto alternatives, gluten-free alternatives, vegan alternatives. Like they're very common, and maybe in other American states, they're not as common, definitely not in the South, or even other parts of the world. So she's able to find all of these like diet products, probably because she lives in LA, which kind of like fuels her eating disorder. She says something really significant at some point talking about her adolescence, even though I did not mark it in the book, because again, I borrowed it at the library. She said something like, I was never thin enough until I was, until I was too much, meaning that she was restricting her eating habits so much that at some point she lost too much weight and became anorexic. And during her recovery, the dietitian would reintroduce certain foods methodically, and she would like count calories to make sure that she was eating enough. And even after like years, this calories eating stayed with her, and that's what this is how the book starts, with her counting her calories throughout the day, and almost like an obsession. Besides food, another theme is religion. So as I said, she's Jewish, food is pretty much this, like, religion is pretty much related to food, because there are like the Jewish religion is, there are many dishes that are typical of the Jewish religion. And she recalls of when her grandparents would bring her to New York, and they would go eat, like, they would eat quite a lot, and she would feel happy, and then she would go back home, and her mother would shame her, and blah blah blah. But food and religion are pretty much related. But she does, she interrogates herself about the responsibility of Israel in like the situation in Palestine. So right now, and she says it herself, she is really like, she's Jewish just because, I mean, she was raised Jewish, but she was not Orthodox, and right now she kind of doesn't believe anymore. But there is some imagery that she definitely believes in, like omens or something. And I do not remember all the symbols that she kind of mentions, because I'm not Jewish. But it's just interesting how this theme, it kind of like comes back throughout the book. Another theme that could be connected to the mommy issues one is like sexuality. Like, she has a very fervid imagination and a very like dirty mind. Even though at first it's not that we don't like see that, but as she's restricting calories, it's like she's restricting her sexuality as well. But together with food, she also craves sexual interaction, and especially with women. And she fantasized about a co-worker of her called Anna, and she envisions like herself having sex with Anna, and sort of like kind of imagining scenarios where Anna is her mother and she loves her. So this is pretty heartbreaking to think that like she can, like, she basically gets off to the idea of her mother being proud of her, which is something that she doesn't feel she had in real life. There's also another passage, this more so related to the mommy issues, where she says that in her adolescence, like, she will look at other mothers being loving to their daughters, and she would feel jealous that her mother was not being like that. Like, she wanted to have them as her mother, but she didn't. Like, she feels this lack very deeply. Me is the anthem of success, So put on mascara and your party dress. I'm your national. I think I've touched on all the themes that I've encountered. What's interesting to me is all of these themes sort of they like gather in just one person, in just one character, who's the character of Miriam. Miriam is a fat, I don't know if I should use the term obese, but she's a Jewish yogurt maker, or she works for her parents' yogurt making business. And she, at some point, she coincidentally starts to work at the yogurt place where Rachel gets her basically yogurt after lunch, which is close to her office. And that's where they meet. And the very first thing that she notices of her is how big she is, and the fact that she's unapologetically big, and she doesn't need to, it's like the opposite of her. It's like she's so concerned with like covering, not just like covering herself, but she's looking skinny. And Miriam is not, like, at first, they're kind of like the complete opposite. And from there, and it's going to be Miriam that sort of, like, brings her, like, first of all, it's going to be Miriam that sort of breaks this curse of the calories counting thing. I will not be spoiling too much in my review, but let's just say that it's her who sort of, like, helps her heal from this course of counting calories. And she invites her to her family Shabbat, so she sort of brings her closer to religion as well. Then I don't think that Rachel sees her as like a motherly figure, because Miriam is younger than her. But she does have, she sort of like worships Miriam. Like she, there are many descriptions of how, yeah, like where she says that she finds her not just attractive, but she finds her just gorgeous, almost like godly. And like she just loves her body, even though, yeah, it's like complete, it's what she's trying to avoid, basically. She wants, she doesn't want to become like that, but maybe she secretly wants to be her, or she wants to have the confidence of not caring what other people think of her. So that's really interesting. And just a side note, like despite all these, like all this veneration for Miriam, I don't know why, but when I was reading, I was picturing Miriam as like a very goofy, clumsy, like just like a young girl, like a 20 something year old, who was just happened to be pretty and was just like so very naive. And but yeah, I mean, I kind of envisioned her as, like, Rachel is so attracted to her, even though she notices all the like clumsy and like ridiculous things about her, even though she is like not perfect, and she is not like, let's say, delicate. Yeah, it's just interesting, because there are some descriptions of how clumsy she is, like she cannot even put on like a lip gloss. Obviously, like she eats a lot, so there are descriptions of herself like stuffing her food, her face with food, which is not something that's like appealing to everybody. But it's just interesting how we don't have like the classical love interest who's like perfect and just pretty no matter what. Like we actually have like a very imperfect and very human love interest here. But yeah, I absolutely loved the novel. I would have so many things to say about like the spoiler part, but I don't want to. Like, I really want you guys to read it. I just thought it was like all these themes and this like recurring elements were so interesting. Like, if I was still in college, I would write a paper about this book. I'm not even joking. I'm really looking forward to reading Melissa Broder's The Pisces. I'm a Pisces, by the way, so I just cannot wait to read that one. Just gonna you take another look at the cover. And now that I'm here, I want to share with you the next book that I will be reading. Actually, I already started it. It's called Severance by Ling Ma. She's a Chinese-American author. And it's an apocalyptic book, apparently. And then I have another one that I want to read after I'm done with Severance. Just a second. Here it is. It's Radical Candor. This one is a nonfiction book. I don't know, maybe this channel will become a book reviews channel. But I don't know, I'm just reading so many interesting things lately, so I thought of sharing my thoughts with you guys. And I am curious to see what you guys think about this book if you read it. And please leave your thoughts in the comments down below, and I'll see you at the next video. It's a love story for the new age, for the 6 page, want a quick stick brand.